Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today in celebrating Hacienda's 45th year of taking care of Arizona's most medically fragile, developmentally disabled, and non-developmentally disabled infants, children, teens, and young adults. 45 years, it's hard to imagine. There are several VIPs in the audience that I would like to introduce, and if you could just stand and wave to the crowd, I'd really appreciate it. Representative Catherine Miranda. Representative Ruben Diego. My good friend, who I met with yesterday. You are my good friend, right? Okay. Vice Mayor Michael Johnson. Members of Ilene Butler's family, Jerry Schwartz and her husband. And Dennis Mundy, her nephew. Thank you all for being here. I really appreciate it. I know you're all busy. The invocation will be delivered by Elder Kim Baker. Elder Baker is a native of Arizona. He's an ordained elder to the Churches of God in Christ. And Elder Baker ministers the Word of God with power, authority, and conviction. Elder Baker.
Good morning. I do nothing without causing those that are involved to be participational. Is that all right? So the hand next to you, I need you to take that hand as a sign of unison for this special occasion. Is that all right? Come on now, come on, come on. It's okay today. Let's loosen up and let's have a good time here today. That's what I came for. Is that all right today? Hallelujah. There's just a little hymn that I do before I pray because it helps to set the tone for me. So y'all just bear with me for a minute, all right? I need thee, oh, I need thee every hour. I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. Gracious Father, we come unto you this morning, O God. Look into none other than the God of our salvation. We just want to thank you today collectively, God, for being so wonderful and so mindful and how you have been with us, God, through these 45 years of servitude. Individually and collectively, God, we've heard your voice. Whether we recognize it or not, we heard you speaking to us. Care for my sheep. And so this morning, God, we come to invoke your presence into this memorial. We ask that you would just bless each and every one that's here today, oh God. That you would strengthen us, God, for the journey that is still yet ahead, God. Because we understand, God, with each other, we are better, we are stronger, we are more united. And so this morning, God, on the legacy that Ilene left us, God, we join hands together saying, through us, God, do like you did through her. Oh, help our hands to be hands of help. Help us to see needs that are greater than our necessary needs. And then give us the courage to step out on what we believe you are calling us to do, for that's what Ilene did. So, God, we thank you this morning for the family that is here today, God, representing her honor and her legacy. Continue to strengthen them, lead and guide, God. For as their eyes behold the wonder of the glory you birthed in her heart here today, God, let them see the greatness that she laid, the foundation she laid, is even traveling in them today. God, in us right now, we thank you right now for each and every one that's here. Bless us, strengthen us, lead us and guide us to higher ground. This prayer and blessing we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Elder Baker. What a beautiful voice. I want you to know that Elder Baker comes here many Sundays and sings to the children of Hacienda. And it's wonderful because his family has been with Hacienda for over 30 years. His mother, Mary Baker, used to work here, and now she comes and she volunteers. And her daughter has worked here as well. So it's wonderful to see families that still have the connection with Hacienda. And speaking of families, I want to introduce to you Jerry Schwartz. Now, my name is Sierra, and I've had the privilege of working on this project about Ilene Butler and what she did for Hacienda. Jerry was the one that filled me in with a lot of the information, and I want her to share her story about Ilene. Jerry, please come on up.
Well, as you know, my name is Jerry, better officially Geraldine. I go by Jerry. And I have to say, Ilene was my favorite aunt, and I was her favorite niece. Having lost my mother at a very young age, Ilene became my second mother and my inspiration. My husband, Jerry, is also here, and Ilene's nephew, Dennis, my brother, who also grew up under Ilene's influence. We inherited the Butler spark, stubbornness, determination, whatever it's called. But I think all of us inherited the main goal of trying to serve the underdog. Better? We came here from Michigan to help in this dedication. And I have to say it's a little warmer here. But I would like to tell you some basic facts of who Ilene was. Ilene was born Ilene May Butler on October 10th, 1935 in Monroe, Michigan. She was born to Roy and Levina Butler. Ilene was the youngest of seven children, which grew actually to nine when my grandparents adopted two grandchildren. Ilene attended the Monroe Public Schools, lived and worked in Monroe until her early 20s. And wanderlust struck. She went to New Jersey for a short time, to Chicago for a short time where I visited her, but those were just regular jobs. When she came home, she had always attended the Trinity Lutheran Church, and Reverend Fainer talked to her, and he spoke of a children's home in Watertown, Wisconsin. And he said, you know, Ilene, they could really use someone like you. So Ilene left for Wisconsin. I went out there and stayed with her for a couple days and worked with her. And she actually had the children that were the most disabled. And she was phenomenal with them. She soon, I think, got the wanderlust again and started heading for California. And her beat up car made it to Phoenix. Her car broke down. So she said, well, I guess somebody's got a plan. I'm supposed to stay in Phoenix. So she went to work for a state hospital for a short period of time. And like usual, she kind of did not like bureaucracy. And then she also hurt her back. So she was home, and she decided that she would. She saw an article in the paper. I remember her telling me about it, about children needing a place to live. So she became a foster parent. She lived in a trailer park, and I know some of the neighbors wasn't too pleased, and that's how Steve Friedman came into the picture, and I never forgot his name. I don't know why. But her love of children was always, always there, and it included our large family. There were more than 50 by the time we all got down there at Christmas time. My grandfather was a big man. Eileen was a larger woman. And when she walked in a room, she didn't just enter the room. She was a force of nature. And she definitely would give her viewpoint. And when they told her that her first child, foster child, did not need a surgery, she had, was hydrocephalus. It would not cure the condition. It would only extend her life. Eileen's question was, well, so what? She needs a surgery. And she fought. And she got surgery. They would. She never did get to adopt Cindy, but she did get the surgery, and Cindy lived 2 more years. She always projected acceptance and love, and everywhere she went, she had support. The people of Monroe continued to support the Hacienda when she would come home, the Ladies' Aid Society at both Trinity Lutheran and Good Shepherd. Lutheran churches always made things. My aunt went to one, so she took care of Good Shepherd. Eileen would bring the kids home, so we'd all go through closets and find stuff that they needed. My grandparents moved out here once he retired, and they become the grandfather and grandmother. My grandmother became certified for a dietitian, and she would cook for them. And I actually, going through all this stuff, found a letter that she had written in 1976 to me. And Eileen had moved to another facility or another place, and it was on Stapley, that's all I know. But she was talking about how she thought they would never get done cleaning and painting. Only 16 rooms and 8 bathrooms, 12 big closets, and so many cupboards and shelves. I put contact paper on all the shelves. I don't think there's much more of the stuff in Phoenix. Eileen was actually in Tucson at that time at a convention. And Granny talks about she baked 3 apple pies, 1 cherry, 1 blueberry, 1 banana cream today, and yesterday she made a big pot of chili. And that's in Arizona. I'm not quite sure what month. She didn't put that in there. But over the time, Eileen's brother Leon also came out, and he assisted Eileen. And my brother Daryl came out for a couple of years and graduated from high school because Eileen would not let anyone talk about not going to school. And then Daryl became a big brother, a cousin with these kids, and each of us became involved when Eileen would bring him home each year. Eileen provided much more than just a place to live or a facility. What they tried to do was give these children a home, and that's what I feel the minute I walked in here. Having started this exactly almost 2 years ago. And actually almost to the day Eileen died, July 3rd of 1995. And so it's very appropriate. I also found a poem, and I gave credit to Andy Riggs. Who Andy Riggs is, I'm not sure. My aunt, Eileen only has one remaining sister, and she's 92 years old. So needless to say, getting some of this information has been very hard. But this was written on one of the back sheets of Eileen's actually papers that she used to evaluate the children, and on the other side is how the designated things that they used. But Andy wrote and titled this, The Little People. Come see our little people, so twisted and so bent. This I am sure my Jesus never meant. But these eyes flash like lightning and their smiles so bright and gay, I am sure it would turn old Satan around the other way. The Hacienda is where the little people dwell. They have no fancy fixtures, no house upon the hill. But they stole the hearts of heaven like yours, I know they will. They have a guardian angel that watches over them day and night. She looks to their every comfort. She always holds them tight. Now, I never met an angel, and I guess I never will. But I met Ilene Butler, so God knows all is well. And I had a copy of this made, which I'm going to leave for the facility. And I also wanted to mention that the necklace I'm wearing is a Degrassi. And all I know, again, is stories handed down. but during one of the functions of raising money, he was kind enough to donate the proceeds from various things. And he presented this to Ilene. And someday, I'm not quite ready to part with it, but one day this too will come to Hacienda. And hopefully, if I can convince my husband that Arizona might be a nice place to live, it's not always so hot, then I would love to continue Eileen's tradition. And I want to thank Mr. Timmons and Sierra. Never in 100 years did I think 2 years ago, when I was feeling a little depressed on the day my mother died, and just a year after my youngest brother died. And I got up, and the picture that you see on your bulletin today, my grandma always had from the time I was a very little girl. That picture was on her table. And I walked in the bedroom to open the blinds, and I looked outside, and it was a beautiful day. It was May 17th, and I turned around, and there was Eileen's picture with her card of Hacienda de Los Angeles, home of the angels. And so I guess that's the Eileen in me. I went to the computer and started Googling. And as they say, the rest is history. So here we are. But I want to thank everyone so much. This would make Eileen would say, I don't know what all the fuss is. But her family says, thank you so much. We appreciate it more than you will ever know. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jerry. The next person I'd like to introduce is the gentleman that actually helped Eileen incorporate Hacienda as a nonprofit. Steve Friedman is an attorney, and he's still practicing today, but he has contributed so much as far as being on boards of many different charities. He was on the board of Hacienda de Los Angeles when it was started, and he worked tirelessly, giving many hours to help Eileen. And he has some very interesting stories, so I would like to bring him up and let him tell you his side of Eileen. Thank you.
Thank you. You're brave wearing a coat today. I thought about it, and I looked at the temperature and looked at the sun and thought about it again and didn't realize we'd have this nice tent to be under, but it was 1967, the year my wife Mary and I married. I was 1 year out of law school handling any kind of case. Potential clients would ask me, what's your specialty? And I'd say, what's your problem? That's it. I met Ilene Butler when she was referred to me by a friend who was then working at legal services. I think it was called Community Legal Services in those days. Ilene had been an aide, as Jerry said. Ilene had been working at the Arizona State Hospital, and she injured herself lifting a patient or trying to help lift a patient. She had injured her back and filed a workers' compensation claim. The Industrial Commission had given her a problem. They initially denied the claim, and she came to me to handle that claim. And I went to battle for Eileen and eventually convinced the Industrial Commission that she was entitled to benefits. But she was still suffering from the bad back as a result of the injury she suffered, and for which she received benefits, not generous benefits, but some benefits for the rest of her life. But she couldn't go back to work at the state hospital. She couldn't go back to work in any job that required heavy lifting. Jerry shared with you how Eileen got into foster care. I was there when she began taking foster children, not as a business, but as a labor of love. Ilene was a large person, as Jerry mentioned. She was tall, she was heavy boned, but as tall and as large as she was, her body was barely big enough for her heart. Ilene lived in a mobile home not far from here in South Phoenix. And she began to take in foster children, but not just foster children. Her foster children were her angels. They were severely and profoundly handicapped children. Maybe one reason she turned to children was because they weren't too heavy for her to lift. But she overcame the back problems and lifted some pretty hefty kids over the years. One of her neighbors was unhappy of what Ilene was doing. Ilene Butler and her angels were offensive to this neighbor. Why, I'll never know. But he began a series of calls to agencies complaining about Eileen's activities and the fact that she had the children in her mobile home. That resulted in inspections by the Department of Health, the Building Department, the Fire Department, the electrical inspectors, and more. She was constantly being bothered having to lead an inspector through the facility, through the mobile home. She passed everything, but it was still aggravating. Next, this neighbor, whose role in the whole story is glorified by what happened, but was aggravating at the time, began to complain to the mobile home park because he claimed Ilene was running a business. And that was prohibited under the rules of the mobile home park. She could not run a business out of her mobile home. What to do? Ken Killian was Eileen's pastor, and he and Ilene and I had a meeting at his church, which was not far from here also. And I recall that she and Ken and I sat in his church and brainstormed as to what to do next. And I have to claim credit. I believe it was me, nobody else is here to deny it, who said, you know what, Ilene, if they're going to claim you're a business, why don't you become a business? Why don't you incorporate, become a business, and let's see what can happen with this. You have support from the community. By this time, other people knew what Ilene was doing, primarily through her Lutheran church. And she said, okay. I had never incorporated a 501c3 corporation, but I went to a friend who did and learned how to do it. And Hacienda de Los Angeles was born. I think my Ilene, Ken Killian, I, and I think Leon was one of the incorporators. I think you have the original corporate papers. And I think that the four of us were the incorporators. A series of miracles came together. Hacienda de Los Angeles was incorporated and moved into a large home at 19th Avenue and Northern. I saw somewhere on one of the walls that it said it was a three-bedroom home, but it sure seemed bigger than that. It had a basement. It had plenty of room on the first floor that were converted. Rooms were converted into rooms that accommodated the children. And it was, the home was by the grace of some people in the church whose name I can't remember. And they said they rented the, somewhere it says that the home was rented to Hacienda, but it was rented for a very cheap rate, if we paid rent at all. And I don't remember what the rent was, but it was not very expensive. It was, the family who owned the property had planned to develop it, and they had nothing to do until it was developed, so they rented it to Hacienda. It's now a McDonald's, because they eventually did develop it after we found the property here. I saw a picture of a guy named Jim Sullivan, whose name doesn't appear anywhere on the boards, but Jim was, I believe, the fellow who actually found this property and helped arrange the financing. Hacienda grew beyond any of our dreams and eventually moved into the first building that was on this property. I served on the board of Hacienda and as president for many years, but eventually left the Hacienda board. And I've been involved with other nonprofits over the years, as Vice Mayor Johnson knows. He and I serve on a board together. And I had sort of lost touch with Hacienda until about 5 years ago. One day, a woman who had been my secretary for 8 years in my law practice came into my office in tears. I was startled. I said, what's wrong? Why are you crying? And she told me that after 8 years, I finally, for the first time, saw your curriculum vitae, Steve. And it says that you were one of the founders of Hacienda de Los Angeles. I said, yes, I was. And she said, my son has been a resident at Hacienda de Los Angeles for over 20 years, since almost after the day, within months after he was born, severely and profoundly handicapped. And Hacienda has done more for him than I ever would have thought possible. The work Hacienda has done and does are among my proudest accomplishments because I was there at the beginning. Thanks to Ilene Butler and the hundreds of dedicated people who have followed her and her lead and her example, it is fitting that some part of the facility be dedicated to Ilene Butler, because it was her heart and her tenacity that was the beginning of Hacienda Healthcare and will carry it into the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Steve. It's my great pleasure to reintroduce to you Bill Timmons, the CEO of Hacienda. And I just wanted to let you know that I've been with Hacienda just a relatively short period of time. However, since I've been here, I've heard so many great things that Bill has done to grow the organization. And without him, many of the things that you see today would not have been possible. So please re-welcome Bill Timmons.
Well, you've heard from Jerry and Steve some information about Ilene. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk to you about Ilene again, and I'm going to bring forward then what Ilene did to the current day. A remarkable woman, as you already heard, and I'm sure that what I say will make you understand that she was even more remarkable than her niece and Steve have indicated. I want to tell you a story. It's a true story. It's a story filled with pain, suffering, prejudice, discrimination, persistence, determination, compassion, and more love than you can ever imagine. It's a story about Ilene Butler. The title of this story, A Woman on a Mission. And as you already heard, she was definitely a woman on a mission. The story begins in her car on Old Route 66, traveling to California for a new life. And as already indicated, she never made it. Her car broke down, and she became a resident of Arizona. In 1967, Eileen's love for children and not being ready for marriage, she applied to be a foster parent. However, her application was denied because you couldn't be a foster parent if you were single back then. But she was undeterred. She knew that it was very difficult to place developmentally disabled children, especially those with physical disabilities and medical problems. So she reapplied, and she was approved. And things began to change dramatically. Those of you who had an opportunity to look at the history in the dining area saw this little girl. You may not have realized who she was. But Eileen's first foster child was a very, very medically complicated little girl with major medical problems. In her very short life, she endured more than most people endure their entire lives. Blonde hair, big blue eyes. Her name was Cindy. The bond between Cindy and Eileen was seen by everyone that encountered them, and that was a lot of people, because Eileen and Cindy went everywhere together. If you saw Eileen, Cindy was with her. It wasn't long that after that Cindy needed life-saving surgery that if she didn't have, she would die. The state, in all its wisdom, said, we're not going to pay for that surgery. And as you already heard, persistence and determination, compassion and love won out, because Eileen said, I'm going to sue you if you don't provide the coverage. And she probably said, and I'm going to tell the world about it. Well, guess what? They approved the surgery. It was shortly after that that Eileen decided to adopt Cindy. Being a foster parent wasn't enough. She wanted to be legally responsible for Cindy and her life. Just like now, the adoption process is quite lengthy. And as it was nearing completion, Cindy's medical problems got the best of her. On the day before the adoption was to be finalized, Cindy died. A few months after Cindy's death, Eileen was quoted in the newspaper as saying, after Cindy's death, I decided to devote myself wholeheartedly to children like her. And boy, did she do that in spades. She became a foster parent for several other children and wanted to be a foster parent for others. As Steve indicated, she didn't have enough space. There were neighbors who were complaining. Steve suggested incorporate. And on November 10th, 1970, Hacienda de Los Angeles, home of the Angels, became reality. Steve? Things would not be the same today without you. Thank you very much. Even that facility was not big enough for Eileen. They mentioned that she was a big woman and had a big heart. There's no doubt about that. and she wrapped her arms around every kid that she could get a hold of to be able to change their lives. With the help of friends and her and two churches, as I understand it, $40,000. Not very much, but you got to remember how long ago this was raised to buy land, this land, and to erect a facility that's on the western portion of this campus to accommodate up to 40 kids. 40 kids. From Cindy to 40 kids in not very much time. A Beach Boys concert was held in Queen Creek to raise money. A donated De Grazia painting was donated to raise money. And lo and behold, it wasn't long before everything was paid off. Steve knew Ilene probably better than anyone, except maybe her immediate family. And he's quoted as saying the following. It was all about the kids. She worked tirelessly day and night, but always with a smile. She wanted the kids to have a home-like atmosphere. You got to remember, this was a long time ago. That phraseology is part of what we live today. But Ilene was ahead of her time. She hated with a passion the labeling that these kids received from others. She wanted them to have as normal a life as possible. You'll recall that Ilene wanted to adopt Cindy, and Cindy's death prevented that. But Ilene never gave up the idea of wanting to adopt children. So while caring for all of these other kids, she found time to adopt. As you heard, she died on July 3rd, 1995. She is survived by Minnie, who is 92, her sister, and Ronnie, and Lupe, the two children that she adopted. Ronnie and Lupe lived together. They were able to remain together. And they live in a group home in Houston, Texas. And I've heard that they frequently talk about mom. They talk about mom. They talk about, we know her as Ilene Butler. Ilene's mission began in 1967 when she became a foster parent to one individual, Cindy, in Phoenix. But through the years, Ilene's mission was adopted by many others. They, like her, have dedicated their lives to helping developmentally disabled children who have physical disabilities and health problems, as well as those individuals who are not developmentally disabled. Today, Hacienda Healthcare serves more than 1,200 kids, infants, children, teens, and some young adults every single day in every corner of the state of Arizona. We have 560 employees who care for them. When I was being interviewed by Mr. Johnson yesterday, he talked about the fact that these individuals must have something about them that allows them to do what they do. And I assured him that every day I see something that is remarkable happening, not just here in South Phoenix, but all the other facilities that we operate throughout the state. There's no doubt in my mind whatsoever that just as the state of Arizona is celebrating its 100th anniversary, that Hacienda Healthcare will celebrate its 100th anniversary of serving Arizona's most medically fragile, medically complicated, developmentally disabled, and non-developmentally disabled infants, children, teens, and young adults in 2067. Eileen, you did good. Now, I'd like to introduce you to Ilene Butler. I give you... I mentioned that through the years, many individuals have adopted Eileen's mission. What's interesting is, once they do that, it's their mission forever. The person who painted that portrait of Eileen has been on Hacienda's board of directors for 31 years. I don't think that that can be matched by anyone else. His name is Tom Pomeroy. He's the person that hired me 23 years ago. And I love everything about what happened during those 23 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bill. Now, you're probably wondering, where do some of our children come from? And I want to let you know that there are many different circumstances that bring children to Hacienda. And one of our initiatives is to help prevent some of the issues, some of the problems that some of the kids endure. And so what we do is we participate in a lot of prevention programs. Now, some of these children that come to Hacienda come to us because of an accident. It may be a very bad accident. Some of them may come to us because they were born with a debilitating disease, and so their families cannot take care of them. Others come to us, unfortunately, because of child abuse. One other area that is very important to Hacienda is drowning prevention. And I want to introduce a parent to you by the name of Rose Bennett, who's going to share her story. Because even though we take care of all these different children, prevention, if we can prevent something from happening, we want to be a part of that. So please welcome Rose Bennett.
Good morning. I'm not a public speaker, so please bear with me. You know, we're here today for a lot of different reasons. And really, I feel it's to honor the late Eileen Butler. And it's a woman whose compassion and tenacity has touched millions over the years. And Eileen's dream of family has spread, and it really has impacted us personally. On June 2nd, 2009, our lives were forever changed. And while my son was at a summer day camp, he nearly drowned. And that led us on a journey to spend nearly 7 months in a hospital. And all but 6 weeks were spent up in Phoenix. And I remember it was nearly 3 years ago, a social worker came into my son's hospital room while we were at UMC in Tucson. And she told us that we were going to be moved to a place called Hacienda, and then it was going to be up here in Phoenix. And I remember the sheer panic of being away from our family and just being in a different place entirely. And I will never forget that first day when we walked through the doors here, because it was the day that we met our family. You know, I am forever grateful to the staff here. And I know I'm gonna forget a lot of people, and I apologize because I don't wanna stay up here too long, but I'm gonna mention some people. Some people like Dan, who always made us laugh with his dog impersonations, and with Sonia and her love of all things U of A. With Brian Henry and his wonderful laugh, with a resident named Jabri, who would have sleepovers. He'd have some staff members place him in a Jerry chair, and they would wheel him into my son's room, and they would put it right next to his bed, and we would stay up watching movies. And because of Jabri, my son has been able to go to prom, because they have prom here. With Lupe and her million-dollar smile, Nathaniel and Melissa and their goofiness and love of karaoke, and last but certainly not least, Katie, who was the first person we met here and who became my best friend. She would bring me food. She would sit and talk to me. She would bring me magazines. She helped me to feel normal. And when my son was able to take day trips outside of the facility, she would go and borrow her dad's truck, and we would put Ethan in the truck and his wheelchair in the back, and she'd take us all over, and she'd introduce us to a place called Lolo's, which, if you haven't been, amazing, amazing. You know, it was because of her that my son got to go trick-or-treating. It's because of her that even though our birthdays were spent in a hospital, we had a place for my family to come up to have a birthday party and to have cake and to have that feeling of normality again. She showed us that although things were different, there were things that were still the same. So I just wanted to thank Ilene and her family with all of my heart, because her dream of family is still alive. And I hope and I pray that one day I can become half the woman that she was. And I just want to thank everybody. They took something that was so tragic and so life-altering, and they gave us hope and a dream. And because of her, I was inspired to start a nonprofit for my son to help other special needs children so they wouldn't have to suffer the way my son suffered, and they wouldn't have to fight for the basic medical necessities that should just be given to children. And we started a nonprofit called Ethan's Buddies, so I encourage you to Google it and to learn more about it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rose. Thank you, Ethan. I want to tell you that Rose is a very courageous woman, and she reminds me of Ilene as well, because there are not very many parents that are willing to talk about their story and share their story of tragedy. But Rose lives in Tucson, and she is actively out there talking about drowning prevention. She is out there, she interviews, she's on television, she's on the radio. She's not afraid to talk, even though it's very emotional, as you can see. So thank you, Rose, for being an advocate, and thank you so much for sharing with us today. Now, as far as drowning prevention is concerned, there are many organizations, and one of them we belong to. And I'd like to bring up Tracy Fate. She represents the Drowning Prevention Coalition of Arizona. She's just going to talk a little bit about the packages that you've received today. And Tracy, would you please come up? Thank you.
Hi, I feel so privileged to be here today. I had the privilege of meeting Rose and Ethan almost a year ago. We were down in the Tucson area having one of our coalition meetings. And Rose walked in with Ethan, and her contagious smile and Ethan's contagious smile was amazing. She is the most wonderful woman. And I think when they say she's a lot like Irene, just from everything I heard today, it is so wonderful that we do have people like Rose and Irene to be here. The Drowning Coalition is composed of parents, health and safety professionals, business leaders throughout the community, and concerned citizens. Together, we come together to try to prevent drownings, and it is truly a passion for all of us that are involved. The Drowning Coalition has been around for over 20 years and truly was started by parents just like Rose. We all know that there isn't one way that we can prevent drowning, but together, through all of us, there are several things that we can do to truly make a difference. We believe in block, watch, and learn. And that's truly that we have to block those areas and keep children away from pools, keep children away from canals, and truly make it so that our children can't get into those dangerous situations. We also learn to watch our children. In the bags that you guys received today, you all received our Walk for Water bags. Every single year in Arizona, for the past 6 years, we have been doing a Walk for Water Safety, and that's walking to homes and delivering to caregivers a bag that has drowning prevention material in it. We did 60,000 bags this year all over the state of Arizona, and in that bag, you'll see that there's a wrist tag. Our wrist tags are truly making one person become the lifeguards. So many times we've heard of those tragedies where there's been a party and there's been many adults around the party, but everyone thought somebody else were watching the children. This truly makes one person responsible for those kids so that they have that eye-to-eye supervision on those children, and they're close enough to touch those smaller children, making a huge difference in preventing drownings. And then, of course, learn. We all know that it's very important for us all to learn CPR. Adults and older children should be able to do CPR. And the other thing that the Drowning Prevention Coalition has really been trying to get out is it's very important for our children and our adults to learn how to swim. We have the Water Smart Prescription Program that truly has the doctors talk about drowning prevention and a non-binding prescription that tells them to go out as early as 9 to 12 months and get those children swimming lessons. To date, as of June 27th, we've had 93 water-related incidents in Maricopa and Pima County, and 22 of those have resulted in a death. 9 of those have been children. 13 have been adults. So not only do we need to teach our children how to swim, we also need to make sure that our adults know how to swim. And when we say watch, adults need to learn that they can't be out in the water by themselves. They always need to have a buddy with them. So adults need to be watching the children, and adults need to have a buddy when they swim so that we can prevent these preventable drownings and deaths. If you could go to preventdrowning.org, you will see our coalition. It will talk about all our members, all the different things we do, and all the events that we support throughout the years. If you would like to be a member, we would love to have you. Because of children like Ethan and so many others, we need to make a difference, and we can with your help. So thank you for inviting me here.
Thank you very much, Tracy. Well, as you can see, not only do we have caring staff, but we also partner with other organizations. And one of the other areas that's extremely important is government. And we have invited our representative, Catherine Miranda, to come here today. She is our representative for our district. She is a first-time representative, and she has done an incredible job. She's been involved with the South Mountain, South Phoenix area for a number of years. Her background has been in education, and she also reminds me of Ilene, because she, one of her passions is to make sure that everybody has an opportunity to go to school, go to college if they want to. And she realized that as an educator, there was only so much that she could do. So she decided she'd run for government and get some of the laws changed. So she's very tenacious, and we're extremely happy to have her. Please welcome Representative Catherine Miranda.
Thank you for that very nice introduction. Good morning. Like she said, I am State Representative Catherine Miranda, but today I want to talk to you as an educator, as a former administrator. I want to share a story with you. Ever since this event was announced, Ilene has been on my mind, and I have a few comments I want to share with you here. But first, I want to talk to you from an administrator's perspective. As an administrator in different districts at different schools, you're expected to evaluate teachers. And every school has a special education department. So here I am with my evaluation. I walk into my special education classrooms, and I'm reading my evaluation, and it says that I'm supposed to observe this teacher getting students engaged. I need to see students manipulate objects. I need to see these students problem solve and interact with their classmates. Well, I walked out of the classroom and I went to my principal and I said, I just left room 305 and these are very medically fragile students. These are victims of drownings. These are brain injury students. How do you expect me to use this instrument and observe this teacher? You know what he said? He said, go figure it out. So I did. I figured it out. I went back in there, and I tore up the evaluation, and I set it aside. And the teacher looked at me, and I said, no, you go ahead and do what you normally do. I'm just going to be here, and I'll observe you. And I was looking for two things. I was looking for love and patience, and that's it. And I saw it happen with this one teacher. But in the years as an administrator, I didn't always see that. And it was frustrating, it was sad for me as an administrator, having those kind of experiences. So the first day I stepped into Hacienda de Los Angeles, this place is so near and dear to my heart, because when I first walked in, I said, they get it. There is love and patience throughout this facility every day. If I had an evaluation instrument, they would all get A's, your whole staff. So I thank you for that. But like I said, ever since this event was announced, Ilene has been on my mind, and I have a few comments here. Once or perhaps twice in anyone's life, there will be a very special place that captures your attention. For me, one such place has been Hacienda de Los Angeles. Today we honor and give thanks to Ilene Butler for her passion and legacy that truly reflect God's work. I have lived in South Phoenix for over 45 years and recall visiting my aunt who lived across from this unique facility for many years. My aunt would often describe the work of this facility, but it was not until recent times that I realized the special work and mission of Bill Timmons and his staff at Hacienda. After visiting this facility several times, I can truly describe their work as a reflection of God's love for humanity. Perhaps the best way to capture the meaning of my words is to look into the eyes of these children and adults. One visit to Hacienda de Los Angeles can change your perspective on the real priorities in life. During my visits, I have also observed the demeanor and patience of the staff. It's rare in life to find in a workplace that brings a satisfaction and touches your heart the way that it happens here at Hacienda. They must truly feel blessed to work somewhere that each day is an opportunity to connect with God. All those who work and those of us who visit Hacienda will turn tears of sadness to tears of joy. To understand the meaning of quality of life, as one has to do is just visit this facility. Anyone's spiritual foundation undoubtedly will find a connection at Hacienda de Los Angeles. We owe a special prayer to Ilene Butler for turning lemons into lemonade and for God's guiding hand that led her to establish Hacienda. Thank you for allowing me to share these words with you.
Thank you very much, Representative Miranda. Well, we are coming very close to the end, and we're saving our very special guest here. As you've already heard his name mentioned several times, I would like to introduce our Vice Mayor, Michael Johnson. Before he comes up, I just want to let you know that he is truly a servant because he has served on the police department for many, many years, retired from there, and then after that, he decided he wanted to continue serving the community and decided to run for city council. So I believe this is his third term, and he was named this year as vice mayor. And as he puts it, he loves District 8, which is the district that we're all in. And he has a great smile, and I want to introduce to you Vice Mayor Michael Johnson.
Thank you. You know, so many people have come up here and had the opportunity to talk about something that many of us believe that not one of us would be able to accomplish. But you've heard them come up here and talk about one person, one mother, one auntie, one friend who impacted and inspired the lives of so many people. One lady, as stated in your program, with love, compassion, and tenacity. One person who started and named the facility Hacienda de Los Angeles, which means big home of the angels. One person started with that in her heart and her mind to reach out and touch the lives of so many people. I've always said from visiting here that we're so blessed every day with what we have and how far that we have come. But I am more blessed to have the opportunity to come to this facility, to be in the presence of all of its workers, because I know that when I'm here, I'm not here with one person. I'm not here with one mother, one auntie, one father, one parent. I'm really here at Hacienda Health I'm here at the home of many angels. Many angels that we have the opportunity to be with, to touch our lives. Ilene was an angel. She created a home full of angels to help aid and care for those who couldn't do for themselves, to provide love and a caring atmosphere for those who were less fortunate than others. Hacienda Healthcare, Hacienda de Los Angeles, is truly a home full of angels. Only an angel could do the work that's being done by Hacienda Health. Only an angel could make the lives and touch the lives of so many families, of so many children, of so many people. You heard a parent come up and talk about how their life was changed around in one day, one moment. Something that we'd never thought would ever happen changed the lives. But how that life was turned around again when she walked into Hacienda de Los Angeles or Hacienda Healthcare and walked into the home full of angels to see the smiles and those that she thanked. She talked about their smiles. She talked about the way they made her feel. She talked about the caring and loving attitude that they shared with her to put their arms around her to make her feel, as she put it, normal again. Only an angel, could do that. So when I think about all that's been said with Ilene Butler, and I listen to all the things that's been said, that we've all been graced. We've all been graced to be in the presence of an angel. And there's many angels in this world, but there are special angels right here at Hacienda Healthcare. And I commend all of the employees, all of the staff, all of the volunteers, all of the people that are here, because your job is the most difficult job, but your job is the most rewarding job. Your job is the one that changes lives, that uplifts people, that give people the opportunity to go out there and help others. You heard the parents say today she was inspired by the angels here to go out and work and inspire others. We can never say that one person can't make a change, because one person, one mother, one auntie, one friend, one lady, but more importantly, summing it up, one angel has made the change in so many lives that has inspired to this day, today, I think he said 1,200 kids are still touched and inspired by one angel that 45 years ago began to do her work, began to do God's work, one angel. So I congratulate and I commend you, all of you angels, and I, more importantly, I thank you for allowing me to be in your presence, to be here at Hacienda de Los Angeles, Hacienda, home of the angels, that I have the opportunity to be here and be graced with your presence. Thank you for all of the good work that you're doing. I thank you on behalf of all of those families who you may not see, who may not talk to, who have struggled and suffered. I thank you for your work that you continue doing, and I thank all of you for taking the opportunity to come. And I'm proud that Ilene was here in South Phoenix, where she set the sacred ground right here at Hacienda to make sure that angels are able to shine and continue to shine. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vice Mayor. That basically concludes our dedication, and I just wanted to let you know, as Vice Mayor said, that it was one person, and you all are like, very much like Ilene. One person can make a big difference. But it does take community. It does take other people. And she wasn't afraid to go out and ask for help. So when we come and ask you for help, you'll know why. But anyway, I want to thank you so much for coming. Please go inside the dining room and enjoy cake and refreshments. And we do have tours, so this is an excellent time for you to take a look at what we're doing here at Hacienda. And if you have any questions, please come up and ask. Thank you so much, and thank you to all the speakers.
Hacienda Healthcare is a 501c3 not-for-profit organization. Donations of all kinds are welcome and are greatly appreciated. Please contact Hacienda Healthcare at 1402 East South Mountain Avenue, Phoenix, Arizona, 85042, or contact them directly at 602-243-4231, or visit them on the web at haciendahealthcare.org.